everybody can take their seats, please.
We don't have enough chairs. We got a few more back there. Thank you all for coming tonight. I know the weather looks like it may get a little rough. I'm Josh Scoggins. I'm an attorney with Lipscomb Johnson and Cumming. I represent Lennar Homes. Here with me tonight is Lennar's division president, Todd Jones. Brian Rochester with Rochester Associates is the site engineer for this project. Justin Hawkins is in my office. And Jim Bowersox is the vice president in charge of land acquisition and development for Lennar. We're here tonight for you to answer your questions and walk you through this project that we've got proposed on Shamley Gap Road. What we're going to do, since we've got a fair number of people here tonight, is I'm just going to start by letting Todd tell you a little bit about Lennar, and then I'm going to walk you through the project, because it is a big project, and then we'll open it up at the end for questions and answers. So with that, Todd, I'll turn it over to you.
Sure. I appreciate everybody coming out tonight. I know evening is not fun, it's hard, especially when the weather's not cooperating. As I said before, my name's Todd. I'm with Lennar. I've been with Lennar for almost 5 years now. Lennar is a publicly held company that we've been building homes since 1954. Really what that means and brings to the community is stability. This is something that we've done numerous times across numerous states, across numerous communities. So in order to do that, we have to do it at a consistent rate, consistent pace, and bring quality and excellence to each of our communities. We're the second largest home builder in the country. We build in 18 states and 54 different markets. Again, what that brings and what I see value in that is that we bring stability. As you know, we've also been through a recent downturn where we saw a lot of our other builders didn't make it through the market. Lennar was still there, stayed with the communities, worked through those communities, and are still building today. Fortune magazine also picked this as one of the top stock picks. Again, it just builds credibility to our stability and our ability to make it through the downturns and build good communities. We also have other affiliated companies. Our primary goal is to build homes and communities and neighborhoods throughout this country, but we also do commercial development, apartment development, large master plan communities on the coast. We also have our own mortgage company, and we also do mortgage-backed securities. Again, all of this is because Lennar is committed to excellence, committed to communities, and committed to what we do in our neighborhoods. The Atlanta Division. We started the Atlanta Division in 2010. I was asked by Lennar to start the division here, and with the intent of growing organically. None of the team that I've been able to assemble is from outside of the city. We all have all of our experience here. Most of us grew up in Georgia, went to school here at Georgia, and live here within not only Atlanta, but also Forsyth County. We have 74 associates, many of which live in Forsyth County. And we recently closed our 1,000th home here in the market since 2010. 16 communities we've already built and closed out. And we're now opening up our 31st community in the Atlanta market. Right now, when you look at our footprint, we're predominantly on the north side. As most of the growth today is on the north side, 85% of all new homes built in Atlanta are within the top five counties, ranging from Gwinnett all the way over to Cobb County, all the way up through Cherokee and Forsyth. Some of the communities that you may have seen as you drive around the county. We just got into Fieldstone Preserve about a year ago. We're building out the remaining home sites there in the back section. Edgeworth, which is part of James Creek. We were finishing up our last homes there. Lake Point, Johns Creek. That's a townhome community in the southern part of the county right off of McGinnis Ferry Road. We're about halfway through that community right now. We're building in the upper 200s. Reserve the Settles Bridge is just down the road from Lambert High School. Great community in which we just opened up the bottom, and we're building in the mid 400s. Shiloh Woods is a community that is off Shiloh Road, in fact, right up to 400. We did a mixture of townhomes and single family detached. townhome start in the high 200s, home start in the upper 300s. Harrison Park is another community we just opened up. That is near Matthews Road, and we opened up that the other day, and that will be in our models in about another 60 days. We have another community that will be opening up in about 90 days off of Ronald Reagan on the southern part of 141. That will be in the anywhere from the 300s really to the 500s. Product for us in Atlanta ranges from townhomes, ranging from about 2,000 square feet, all the way up into product into the 600 and 700s, depending on the community, and what we try to do is match the local area. So really what I'd like to come across with tonight is, you know, while we are a public health company, while we bring stability with our publicly backed financial strength, we're also a local team. We've all been doing it here a long time. I've been in Atlanta for 25 years, went to school here. Jim's been with me for the past 2.5 years. Not only has he developed on his own, he's also worked for many home builders over the last 25 years as well. So while we bring strength and stability, we also bring local talent. Josh?
Thank you. Just to give you an overview of the project, some of you may review the zoning application. What we're seeking to do is rezone 444 acres of agriculturally zoned property on Bethel View and Chamblee Gap Road to a master plan district zoning classification for a development of residential housing that will have a density of 1.57 homes per acre. You can see in the top left-hand corner there where this property is located. Many of you probably live nearby. The site again is bisected by Shamblee Gap Road, the dirt portion of Shamblee Gap Road. You can see that on this transportation map here, the arterial roads and state highways that actually surround this property, Bethel View Road going north to south, Georgia 20, across the top there, orange, and of course 400, and Post Road is a little bit further to the left. And again, here's a map showing the employment centers in this area. Taking a look at this, We'll start with the proposed road improvements to Shamley Gap. Shamley Gap, for those of you who can't see the screen, comes in off of Bethelview here. It actually crosses Bethelview and goes up to 20. Part of this road, as you know, is dirt. What Lennar is planning to do, again, is realign and reconstruct Shamley Gap in order to make it where it can serve not only this property, but really pretty much everything in the region that would come through here. The entrance monument will be put at Bethelview Road so that you have a sense of arrival into this community. Each of the pods within the community are what I would call communities within the community. They will each have their own entrances, own entrance monuments, and each one will have its own unique look and feel to it. This is a zoomed in version of the proposed monument signs. You can see a lot of stacked stone, a lot of rock columns, floorboard horse fencing. We're trying to stick with an equestrian theme throughout this project that not only looks nice and adds value, but also helps keep a more rural looking feel to this. This is the proposed parkway that will come through where Shamley Gap is currently. As you can see, there will be 8-foot wide sidewalks on one side of the street. That way people will be able to access the Big Creek Greenway Trail, which we are donating the land to run through this property. The middle of this section of the road will be landscaped with street trees, and it will have a very nice looking feel, curbed and guttered, and all in all, a nice feel. As this transitions down toward Kelly Mill, we're going to transition the road down so that it loses a parkway look coming off of Bethelview Road and then becomes part of a rural section of road with street trees on each side of the road and maintaining the 8-foot sidewalk. And then as you get down to where we taper off the end of the property, we're going to tie it back into the existing Shamley Gap Road. We're going to sidewalk it still. We're trying to, you know, not widen the road unnecessarily all the way down. This property has a central feature, which everybody can see looks like a bullseye in the middle of the project. That circle is about the size of a football field, just to give you an idea of the scope of the size of the project. That will be the village green area, the focal point of the community. The line you see in yellow running up the east side is a proposed Big Creek Greenway. That greenway will come across Shamley Gap Road to a trailhead that we're working with the county to put on our property. And then it will switch back and forth up the side of the mountain until you get to the ridge line. It'll then run behind our property to the north and then up the east side there on the north. This is the design as it's currently been approved by the board. So that's what that will look like. Again, as far as theming in the community, we're trying to stick with an equestrian theme that's going to, again, add value. Zeroing in on the individual communities, starting with Pod A, which is the brown section, you can see it on that map a little more clearly, in the northeast corner of the property. Those are age targeted to 55 years and older, single family detached homes. You can see an example of those houses here. Typically, you're talking about a more low-level home, ranch, 1.5, not two-story, basements, three-story type houses. These are typically going to be located on smaller lots because the 55 and over community is not typically one that's going to want to take care of a 12, 13,000 square foot lot, mowing grass, all of that. The next section in red, the south of Shamley Gap Road, is an age-targeted attached housing type. It too will be targeted to 55 and over. It'll be a sister community to the age-targeted detached above it. And it too will be on lots that are typically going to be 2 or 3 units, 4 units together. They'll have community gardens in between the houses, things like that, so they remain active. And one thing we're looking at doing, and you can't see it on this plan, if you can back up and go through. Lennar is also looking at installing an amenity right in here just for the senior communities. This targeted to the senior, not targeted to kids. It's not going to have all kinds of things that kids would want in an amenity package. We're looking at doing that so that the people who live in those two communities can have their own self-contained amenities. Go ahead. Neighborhood C is the property that abuts Ashbrook Subdivision. It has the largest lots in the neighborhood. They're minimum 90 feet wide. These lots are going to again be street graded, so there's no mass clearing in this area. Each lot will be created and a house built on it. These houses are going to start at fours and go to fives. Again, here are the typical performance standards. And again, I want to emphasize, because I know there's been some concern for people, these are all. Let me hold the questions till the end. I want to emphasize again, is that better?
No.
These are minimum sizes. That is the absolute smallest something can be. Most likely it's going to be bigger in the cul-de-sacs and other areas. So we're working on trying to determine all of the averages and lot sizes and all that for each individual lot. So as we progress through, I know we'll talk about that more. The two brown pods in the middle, neighborhoods D and E, these are single family detached lots that are on 75 foot wide lot minimums. These are going to be minimum 2,400 square feet in the $400,000 range. Neighborhoods F and G to the north are going to be 60 foot minimum lot sizes. These houses are going to be 2,200 square feet minimum. Again, the minimum house sizes, these can range anywhere from 2,200 square feet to 3,500 square feet and over. It just depends on the individual wanting to buy the house and how much they want to upgrade. In the center, around the focal point in the community, we've got a series of rear access lots in front on the street. You want to jump to that picture, Todd? So you don't have garages facing the street. These will circle around the village green in the middle, giving it a more street-friendly colonial look. Again, theming in the community, Lennar is putting several million dollars in the amenity package. It's going to have athletic facilities, meeting rooms. You're talking about fire pits, all that different stuff. We'll jump into that a little bit more as well. I'll have a lot of history. Go ahead. As far as, again, meeting in the community, this is one that we're trying to make where people can sort of age in place. Go from your family to having parents or grandparents living in the senior targeted areas. So this has got something for all ages. And with that, I'd like to take just a few minutes, hopefully the rain will stop long enough for people to hear me, to address a couple of concerns that I know people have raised so that we can just open those up. First and foremost are schools. Everybody wants to know how many school kids are coming out of this, what it's going to do. We've met with the school system. We're working with them. The most important thing to keep in mind is that this isn't going to be built this afternoon. This is a project that could be phased anywhere from 5 to 7, 8, 10 years, depending on the market. The school system is in the process of working to evaluate where they're going to put the new elementary school. $195 million bond was just passed that they are using to fund these improvements. A lot of the tax dollars that come to pay back those bonds will probably be generated in a community just like this. And I think one of the other important things to recognize is that growth in this county is what has helped the schools become what they are. I know my partner Emory was one classroom. They were concerned about growth because they couldn't build a school to accommodate people when they had a population of 15,000. So we've never had a child go without a seat, and we're working to partner with the school system to
help them in any way we can to mitigate the impact. Again, the senior targeted areas don't generate children, so not all of the development will have an impact. This is in the central school district, high school district, Kelly Mill Elementary, and I believe Hawkins Middle. So just to give you an idea of where it started. The next item, I know everybody thinks about is traffic. Obviously, you don't put this many houses into an area without increasing traffic. That goes back to the widening and the realignment of Shamba Gap. Lennar is actually installing a traffic light at Bethel View and Shamba Gap. They're also installing a traffic light at Kelly Mill at the school in Shamba Gap. Bethel View Road is being widened. We have, they're currently trying to finish a right-of-way acquisition along this third segment. So that project is a reality and is no longer, you know, 40 years away. So we are doing everything we can, not only to handle the traffic from our project, but also to help improve transportation overall with the improvements. The other thing that I've heard people raise concerns about are the lot sizes. This is a very difficult point to talk about because it always has a trade-off between preserving open space and saving streams and trying to protect environmentally sensitive areas in exchange for having smaller lots. What you see in a lot of the older subdivisions, and if this were a Res 2 or some other lower density type straight single family zoning, is there's no open space. Everything is lots all the way to the property line. Lots through the streams, lots through the lakes. That's how those lots get to be the size they are. What Lennar is doing is trying to keep all of the lots out of the stream buffers, out of the wetlands, out of the, off the side of the mountain, and trying to confine those areas because those areas will be maintained by the HOA. My experience has been that when a property owner, a homeowner owns something, they are going to improve it, whether they're supposed to or not. It will be fenced, the trees will be taken down, a swing set will pop up overnight. It is a lot easier to enforce all of these buffer restrictions, all protect all these environmental treasures that they have on this site by keeping that property out of the hands of the lot owner. So when we talk about lot size, let's remember that it's intended to limit the disturbance. It's not intended to make lots small for the sake of making them small. We can make them a lot bigger without having 200 acres of open space. So we're trying to, again, minimize that impact. So with those points, I will open it up to questions. I'll try to repeat the questions when I hear them so we can pick them up. Yes, ma'am?
I'm a science major, and don't think I'm a kook. I'm fairly bright. I am always concerned about the terrain. People that mess with their terrain and nature end up, that's why you've got slides out in Colorado and stuff. You start messing with our terrain. Right now, we are hit by tornadoes and things. I'm concerned about our terrain and what if y'all are going to build around with the terrain.
So you're concerned about changing the shape of
yes.
the land?
Yes.
We are trying, again, that's part of keeping the lots into the pastures. We're trying to just go with the topography as much as possible. It's not our goal to come in here and try to flatten something that's not supposed to be flat. So we're definitely cognizant of that.
But it exactly.
And it makes it look nice.
Even the pastures are good.
Right. Yes, ma'am. Back down to where
You still have the 8-foot sidewalk all the way, but we're not going to curb and gutter, we're not going to put medians in the middle. We're trying to transition it back to a rural road down here.
Okay, and then where is that before Johnson Road?
Johnson Road, she's asking where Johnson Road, that comes in right here. The question was, can we run sidewalks all the way down Kelly Mill? I'm sorry, all the way down Shams Gap.
It's just that Kelly Mill Road, the old part of the short space where Shamanda, like there's Shams Gap up there. There's cars in there, the pipes, the amount of water that comes on, so it's too small, Shamanda, and then there's stuff that's growing in these space. And we would like to see a priority because that road's going to be used as a hybrid for everybody.
What can we do to improve Shamsley Gap below our projects? We're certainly willing to work with people. I don't think we can sidewalk between them. So, well, they may, I don't know how far that may be on the project. So,
I'm sure it's kind of long. Can you hear me now?
We couldn't hear her at all.
Actually, I have several questions for Josh and the developer. And the first one is rather basic. Does this development meet the requirements of the comprehensive land use plan?
The question was, does this project meet the comprehensive land use plan? The map that's right over there in the corner shows us a suburban living, which is pretty much most of the county. That is typically density between 1.5 to 2.5. This project is 1.57. The zoning classification itself, the MPD, I don't think that fits within the term that's used in the comprehensive plan. I'll go back and look at it. But the density is at the low end of the range.
When you mentioned, the MPD, does this project meet the requirements of the Unified Development Code for an MPD?
The question again was whether this satisfies the requirements for an MPD. It does, with the exception of one component, which is a 111-acre commercial site that's about twice the size of the avenue from site that would have to be put here in order to make it comply with the commercial component. That has been buried in the past where it makes sense to do a mixed use that has many different price points, many different housing types. On a project of this size, that makes sense. I don't think it makes sense to put a 111-acre commercial center on Shamley Gap Road, but
you want to put none of it, which makes you The answer is no.
The answer,
if you develop it under those rules, then you need to stick to the rules at least somewhat.
Okay. Well, the question was sticking to the rules and not burying the commercial. Before we filed this, we went and met with the planning board. We tried to figure out a way to develop this property with a mixture of uses. So you don't have 650 12,000 square foot lots, all the same size house, all the same size pieces of property. Unfortunately, Forsyth County zoning ordinance does not give the flexibility to anybody to do that outside of the MPD. The only alternative would have been to file for a multifamily zoning district, Res 6, on the entire project, even though we were building $500,000, 3,500 square foot homes. We'd have to call it attached so that we could fit it into the zoning category. And also, or we could have broken this up into four or five different rezoning applications, had four or five of these meetings for different pods of the property, which really made it unwieldy. So I want to emphasize the point that it's not Lennar who's trying to skirt rules or trying to do things that the code doesn't allow. It's us trying to figure out a way to make the government's regulations fit something that we think is going to improve the community.
Sure.
Yes, ma'am.
I grew up with old math, so forgive me if I don't know what new math is. You have 444 acres, correct?
The acreage is 444.
Okay. Both the Z38, whatever it is, both that and you stated that you're going to have close to 200 acres of green space.
Right, the green space calculation, let me address, I'll address that.
If you take, if you take 444 acres and you use 200 of that for green space, you're down to 244 acres for housing, and that makes that a beehive and not a community.
Well, the question or concern raised was the open space, taking the lots down to make the development more compact. The open space that we have is going to have a range between somewhere between 150 and 240. So I use 200 as kind of an average. The reason we put it in there as a range is because you can't count your lots as open space. So if we have to make a lot bigger, make a lot smaller, make a lot move over from one side to another, make the sidewalk a little bit bigger, that is going to change, not drastically, but it's going to change the open space calculation. This site is has a ton of open space on it, and again, when you talk about shrinking the lots and putting in more compact development, that's a trade-off for maintaining the open space and protecting the streams. There's nothing, again, you can have lots that are an acre each that run 600 feet up the side of the mountain, but the HOA can't control that. These individual lot owners do. And that has become a problem, especially with the streams. Because what I've seen in older subdivisions is where you own to the middle of a creek, and something happens and that creek gets dammed up, trash gets in it. I've seen people who've actually had the burden of going in there on their own and having to clean out things like that. And again, it's just, this is sort of the paradigm that we are seeing now and have seen for a while in terms of development. And that is keep, it's not trying to make a lot smaller. It's trying to keep all of the open space areas that are required by the code. When you have subdivisions that aren't res 2, where you run the lots all the way through the stream buffers and up the side of the hill.
I think you're still talking around my question.
When you say you run a, this is 1.75 homes per acre.
5.7.
Okay, I assume you're assuming in that 1.57 the open space too.
That's the way the law, the question was, how is the open space calculated, the county's ordinance?
I didn't ask how it was calculated.
Well, what you're saying, the question was, you're assuming that the open space is being used to lower the density, right?
I am, yes.
Yes. Well, the answer to your question is that the county says, take all the property, divide it by the number of houses, and that's the density, or divide the number of houses by the acres, and that's the density. Every subdivision, every one you live in, is calculated. It's intended to give people an incentive to keep lots out of the environmentally sensitive areas. Let me jump to him and then I'll right back to you. Yes, sir.
You've got the different subdivisions alphabetically arranged. Can you talk about the sequence in which you begin the development? Are you going to try to go ahead and start all at the same time? Or are you going to do them one at a time? And if so, have you already discussed the sequence in which you're going to do that?
The question was, how are we going to phase this in? What's going to be built? I'll let Todd speak to that. We are basically telling you one thing, which the park road will be built first. Before anything's done with anything else, the road will be built. And then I'll let Todd speak to, just a second, let me finish answering his question.
Okay.
Go ahead.
The sequencing of a community will start with the park road. It's the key to the community as well as the village green and the amenity area. So the first set of activity will be down the parkway, connect into Shamley Gap, as we talk about as we transition back in, and then we will bring the road back up to the village green and then to the amenity. Ideally, we would like to be able to get into and start selling in several pods at the same time. That way we attract
more of the buyer profile in the county, and then we can also lessen the time that the community's active. So Parkway first, along with the amenity, and then we'll start opening up the pods off that.
So there's no sequence in place as far as which one we first, and they'll all start at the same time, and whichever ones are taken off first will be the ones that get completed first?
It will also depend on, as we go through the engineering, it'll also depend on sewer location, soils, where we have to move to put the streets. So that will have some impact in it. But primarily, we're going to go to the center of the community and start to fan out from there. Move up towards the amenity and move up from there.
I think you have a question.
You mentioned that the nature is going to be preserved. Are you going to build a barrier fence by the creek?
The question was, are we going to fence the creeks? Again, the goal is not to put in artificial structures where we're not trying. People can use these areas.
So how are you going to preserve from trashing that you mentioned earlier?
The question again was, how are you protecting the creeks if they're not fenced? The main way they are protected is by who owns them. What happens is, again, if you've got 700 individual people you have to enforce the law against, that's unwieldy and it's hard to do and it's not done. I can just tell you because I get phone calls every day from people who built a deck and set back, cut a tree down they weren't supposed to cut down. Keeping it owned by the HOA and showing people this is your property line, you may not put anything over it. That is how you keep stuff out of the streams. These streams are 75 feet on each side of them. You cannot build anything.
Right now,
50 feet. That's actually a very good point. The question was, we're trying to bury it at 25 feet.
Another 700.
If you see that thing right there is about the size of my thumb, that is the stream buffer variance. And it's being requested on 150 feet of about 4 or 5 miles of stream because DOT is widening the road and pushing our entrance back into it. The county itself is not exempt from state stream buffers. They have to get stream buffer variances too whenever they build roads. So what we're trying to do, that one little area, again, 150 feet on however many miles of creeks you see going across the street, is the impact. And again, that is a result of four-laning Bethel View Road, not us. We try to stay out of it. Our goal is to stay as far away from the stream as we possibly can. So we're not out here trying to, I know that was a misconception that had been sort of rumored going around that we were destroying all the streams. Well,
and we're staying out of the state buffer.
That we're not actually asking even to pipe that 150 feet. Brian is exactly right. We're only asking to go down to what the state requires, which is 25 feet on that one little section, which I've been told, and I went and looked at it today, is more of a wet weather ditch. Let me grab him and then I'll come back.
Yes. Brian Weslowski, good to see you.
Oh, good to see you again.
Good to see you as well. So, as you know, I own the 20 acres there in the bottom corner.
Yes.
We spoke about the greenway before. You know, county and the greenway on property. And I've got a meander through where 50 feet from the home we're putting in where I've got to use our outdoor shower if they want to see my checked up. Needless to say, can you speak to how we can work to get that greenway all on our property?
So yeah, the question
property,
is
I know so speaks on more acres above me.
Right. Mr. Weslowski's question is whether we can work to move the greenway onto Lennar's property, because currently it sort of zigzags back and forth across the property line as it goes up the mountain. This is not going to start. It does this kind of crossing the property line as it goes up. We have had preliminary discussions. This is the plan the county has. It was approved. That's what they're required right away for. We have talked with them because you see all these squiggly lines under the bottom? Those are switchbacks that go up the mountain like this because the county has to comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act. So they can't put it like that. That is incredibly expensive. And it's probably going to require building a wall, running a trail.
building a wall, running a trail.
So we have talked with them about possibly, and this is again up to the county, Todd, jump in here at any time if I'm wrong on this, but I think we were trying to sort of move it a little bit to run it more along a topography line as opposed to going like that at the side of the hill. Yes, sir.
Are you working with Tim Allen on that?
The question was, who are we working with? We're working with the engineering department, Tim Allen and John Kennard on that. Yes, sir.
So I have a bit of a selfish concern as well. It might come from a misreading of the plan. Forgive me, I was 10 minutes late to what I was going to do. If we could, did you get it up where you have the lots, where you show the lots?
Sure.
At the top left corner, the left-hand side of the property. Thank you. I think it's A, pot A.
Yes.
Those look to be the smallest, teeniest lots that you've got on this whole property. And correct me if I'm wrong, I thought I saw on the sign you have 120-something attached units going in. The townhomes?
The statement, just so everybody can hear, was that we have the smallest lots in the northeast corner.
That's what I'm saying.
You're right.
Are those townhomes?
The ones up here are not. These are detached lots. They're age targeted. That's why they're small. Age targeted, 55 and over. The ones to the south, which you can see better here, these are townhomes, again, 55 over.
Okay, so those in is it pot A?
Pot A is the top right.
Yeah.
So that's where you get on the left hand side.
Yes.
Okay, so those are smaller units, but they're not multi-level at least.
No, I think they're probably one and a half.
The reason I'm asking is because I own a property that abuts that area, and as I looked at the plan and I said, why in the world, we don't have 1 to 3 acres, why are they putting 4, 3 to 5 properties stacked up on a fence line and potentially with the ability to look into right into our backyard?
Yes.
It seems to me that if you want to, Milton, why can't you build a $500,000 house in my backyard? No, I'm exaggerating, but I exaggerate to illustrate the disparity on both sides and the disparity that I perceive.
Well, you know, that's the point was, can you build bigger lots, more expensive houses up against the north, what I call the northeast side, or northwest side?
To match
what's around it. We're certainly open to looking at different ideas. Again, this is the concept plan, even though it is about 50% engineer. I mean, that's the purpose of having this meeting, so we can hear what you have to say and sit down and try to work something out.
You're in the same subdivision. So, and our property is like 3 to 4 acres of land, and you're going to put people there, one start on top of another.
The statement was,
you want to lose value in our house and property.
The statement again was having smaller lots against larger lots. You live in Shamley Estates, I think.
Yes, I do.
This Shamley Estates, if I'm remembering correctly, is on septic tanks.
Yes, it is.
That's usually why lots are as big as they are, because they have to have septic fields. All of this is on sewers.
Because they made them back in the 80s, the 70s, the land was used to the people.
Well, we're not getting into why, we're just getting, again, it's about the disparity. I mean, I'm about to have 4 or 5 houses on my fence line, with, again, potentially multi-level, potentially they're going to be like, I can only afford so many cypress trees.
We can certainly, take one of my cars and call me.
I can take you out.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Josh, we had talked about this before. Can I use Old Town Bethelview as an example? For those of us who live in Bethelview, and those in Ellison, everybody get rid of that. We went through this, in fact, 10, 12 years ago, where Old Town Bethelview is on 5,000 square foot lots, except for the lots along the perimeter, which adjoining adjacent neighborhoods. And one of the requirements of the developer, and the developer was quite willing to work with us, to put lots along the property line of equivalent size to the lots that they were joining. In other words, our lots are half an acre and larger because we are accepting. And so along the property line between Bethwick and Rivendell, the lots are half an acre or so. The houses are comparable also, and they move the density into the center, which is really what seems like the logical thing to do. You're kind of going about it fast backwards.
To repeat Mr. Lappinghouse's concern, is trying to move density into the middle, putting larger lots on the outside. We have developed this plan to, again, develop the property without impacting all of the trees and the streams. I do understand the issue with
having the higher density housing types backing up to Bethwick and I guess Shambly Estates to the north, am I right?
Yes.
Again, we're early in this process. We're certainly happy to sit down and talk with anybody. We're not ruling anything out at this point. We're trying to figure out a way to make this project the best it can be, so we'll certainly keep working on that. Yes, ma'am.
For the red lights, it's going to be at Kelly Mill Road and Bethel V Road at the ends of Shamley Gap. Are y'all going to put left turn signals in those red lights at all lanes and all directions?
To repeat the question, she was asking if we were installing turn lanes, left
signals,
turn lanes.
Signals.
And, well, signal. Right. Oh, left
arrows.
Left
turn signal at the
arrows
red
lights. Arrows at the traffic signals. I believe that's probably required by GDOT. I can find out the answer. It is. Mr. Bowersox has indicated, yeah, I mean, I'm sure that it wouldn't make sense to just light it without an arrow on it. Yes, sir.
To make note of what Mr. Blackenhouse was talking about, backing up to other lots and stuff, what kind of buffers are you going to be providing between existing homeowners and such? Are you just going to do the minimum, or are you going to actually increase what is required? We were actually able to secure a larger buffer zone between our neighborhood and Old Town Bethany to help minimize the impact on surrounding neighbors.
The question again was, what are we doing in terms of buffering and setbacks? The proposed plan shows 25-foot exterior buffer and 50-foot exterior setback. That's standard when you have residential against residential, but I would like to emphasize that on many of these areas, the two exceptions being here and here, we're trying to maintain as much open space between the different uses as well. So I do understand the issue with respect to that one, because that one, that fortunately what we find ourselves with is the pasture goes all the way to property line on that
particular
piece.
Are you going to add to?
We're certainly in. You know, we're certainly going to look at landscaping, buffer standards, we're going to impose landscaping requirements, we're certainly willing to look at doing something else, figuring out what we can do to mitigate that as much as we can.
Are you talking about an additional property or a buffer there,
well,
or are you just talking
we,
about plants?
I think we need to sit down and talk about it and see what works for you guys. Yes, sir.
Since you're trying to sell the whole community feel to people moving in here, don't you think the lack of commercial is kind of interesting to go with?
The question is whether the lack of commercial tracks from the marketability, I guess, of the neighborhood. In certain areas, I would say probably yes, but here, because the frontage on Bethel View is the only commercial, if you want to call it that, commercial corridor that this touches, the road frontage on Bethel View is only a couple hundred feet. I'm not sure that all of the residents in here would want a large commercial center on Shamley Gap Road. Even though it's improved, it's still not, I mean, it's not a commercial area. The frontage on Bethel View up the corridor, even on Bethel View, is mostly residential.
Well, can I ask, the land across Bethel View on Shamley Gap that continues across, is that commercial and maybe commercial would go in across?
The question is whether the property across Bethel View on Shamley Gap is owned commercial. I don't think it is. I know there are several subdivisions on the north end of Shamley Gap where it goes to 20. I think all of the property across the street may be zoned either agricultural or residential.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, is this going to have way to
I'm sorry, there are a lot of people, so I can't see everybody. Let me get you, and then I'll.
Okay, first, I just wanted to address the subject. This county that are on septic, that are not on one-fifth of an acre lot sizes. I've heard commercial brought up a couple times. If you didn't want the commercial, why did you ask for the master plan development and then throw out the commercial in order to keep the smaller lot sizes? This is not consistent with land use map at all.
The question, again, I think Mr. Laffinghouse asked earlier, was why are you zoning MPD if you don't want to do some commercial? Again, it's not Lennar trying to go around what the land use plan says. It's the county's ordinance being so restrictive that in order to zone this without an MPD, we
would either have to do four or five different applications on distinct pods that have four or five meetings and go through four or five different regional impact reviews, or we can zone the entire project Res 6, which is multifamily residential, even though we're doing...
It's not consistent with land use map Res 6.
No, but what I'm trying to say is in order, when you have a project on property that's this size, it's tailor-made to multiple price points. What happens with multiple price points is you have different performance standards. You might have lots on one side that are a bit smaller. You might have lots over here that are bigger. What happens with that is the county zoning, residential zoning categories are so limiting that you either have to zone this in individual pieces where you're going to have all of these different applications. I think that probably it would be more lucrative to this property's owners to do that. But by keeping it all under Lennar and all having central controls, you have much more continuity. You don't have the problem of people not paying their bank loans and getting foreclosed. So again, it's really the fact that we're trying to find a zoning classification and varying the commercial to us and to the planning department seem more reasonable than filing a Res 6, Res 4, Res 3, Res 2, CBD, and then coming in here for five or six different hearings when we could have had all of this laid out for you at once so everybody can see what's going on.
Land use map calls for suburban living?
It calls for suburban living 1.5 to 2.5 units an acre. This is 1.5.
So for every 3 acres, for every 2 acres,
there's
going to be 3 houses.
Yes. 1.5. So the question was, for every 2 acres, there would be 3 houses.
But the land use you have for the small one, the elderly community, you're putting a lot more housing on that small amount of land, and that allows you to have bigger lots and residents. Am I correct?
The question was, having more compact development in the senior pods allows you to have bigger lots on the rest. That is true. Again, senior pods, I always tell people, because I've zoned a lot of senior housing in this county, I wouldn't focus too much on the lot sizes with senior housing because it's not intended to have small lots. It's just the fact that seniors typically don't want to maintain big lots. So, so typically what you have in these type of areas is maintenance-free living, where the community association takes care of everybody's yards, they take care of everybody's landscaping. So again, that's not, you don't have kids running around.
But I like the idea that you're
sure.
That kind of.
Great. He was holding his hand up for a while. Yes, sir.
Two things. On the senior section or whatever, is that going to be enforced for that? Or how is that done by covenant?
The question is, how is the age limitation enforced? There are two ways to do that. One is what we're proposing is age targeted. That's where Lennar is marketing the property to seniors via the floor plans, one step, steps, low level, law, small lot, not here for the kids, senior amenity. The other way to do it is with what's called a formal age restricted covenant, and that's imposed under federal law. What that does is it says at least 8% of the houses have to be occupied by one person who's 55 or older. And that has been done, I think, in the market generally better than the federal government about keeping something senior. It's supposed to be senior as opposed to, yes, ma'am.
Speaking about seniors, are those senior homes, they all have steps? Will they all have stairways?
The question is, do all senior homes have steps? When I said step, what I'm talking about is the one step, where you don't have five steps to get up to your front door.
What I'm saying is that these ones that back up to the Bethwick subdivisions, they are townhomes?
Yes.
So me being a senior, if I were buying a home, I'd never want to buy a home as a senior with steps. So I don't know how you can call them seniors for seniors. Mm-hmm. They're more like starter homes for young families.
Well, the question was, or the statement was, she thinks the townhomes are more geared toward young families because they're townhomes, and townhomes typically have steps.
I don't know if we have a picture in the PowerPoint, but there is one in the books that were filed with the county. These are one level.
No, I'm talking about the ones behind Bethwick subdivision. Those are the town. Those are town
homes.
That is a town home and they have steps.
Don't think of a town home as a narrow, tall building. It just means it's attached. So
are bedrooms on the first floor?
Yes.
They are. What's on the second floor?
The question is, what's on the second floor? Typically, you may not have a second floor, but if you do, it's typically a loft, maybe a grandkids suite. That's typically what I've seen.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I have a comment first, and then I have a positive question. My comment is, honestly, I just don't like it. I think that this is too big for where we are now.
Okay.
The infrastructure can't handle it. I know they pass bonds for schools, but that's just a green light to bring in more residents. You know, and I moved to this community 12 years ago. A lot of green space, and it's just going away, going away, going away. And
I'm scared.
I might have a little bit better acceptance of this, but the townhomes. I don't like the townhomes there, and I'll tell you why. Because if you put in townhomes, it's going to be a lower cost. It's going to bring in a lower income family. You know, we all see what happened to Duluth and Alpharetta and other parts. More people come in, you got crime comes in, the standard of living goes down. I just think it's too big. I just don't like it.
Then just so everybody can hear, the statement was the townhomes typically cost, you know, lower end, turned into lower product over time.
Right.
The one thing, two things I want to emphasize about this. One is, again, a senior component, so not families.
Yeah.
The second thing is these townhomes are starting in high twos. So even the townhomes are going to be more expensive than many of the areas that surround this property. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I wanted to know how many houses total are in.
The question was how many houses total? It's 696.
696. Okay, on this, can I just stand up? Having this largest acreage, I know, is not, but 696 homes is too many houses. The big parkway is too big for this residential area. It looks like you're going down a main thoroughfare and you have to go parkway with a median in the middle, sidewalks, all that. It's just too large for this, for our area.
The statement was, it's too large. And I'm just trying
it's
to make
too it large. Up. There's too many houses. The road is too big. This has been a dirt road simply because Pete Amos refused to have it paved.
Yes, he didn't want
the track. Exactly. He did not want this track by his house. So he sells this land and says, this is a wonderful thing. You will all love it. Well, guess what? We don't want it. It is too big. We have acreage down. We own down on the other end near Kelly Mills School. The school has been in existence 2 years and they're having trailers next year.
Yeah.
I know that for a fact because my daughter teaches there. And what about all the runoff? That's a lot of houses combined. And you're saying, okay, we're protecting the streams, we're gonna keep the woods, but you take that pasture land that has been up and down and has grass and growing on it, you take that and you flatten it out and put a foundation every so many feet, and you're going to have a lot of runoff that you don't have now. So I think if you could develop this with fewer houses and not this big two-lane road coming off of Bethel View, that maybe we could agree with something, but we totally disagree.
Well, I think you should tell us who those of us who live at the other end of town like that. And I'm sorry, I have to turn into my neighborhood. There is a water pipe bump there where something is going away underneath. The county won't even come out and look at it. They fully admit the pipe that they put under the road into my neighborhood too small. When it rains real hard, everything overflows the road. So you're going to build this beautiful neighborhood, and then everybody's going to come by my house. And my dinky little road that they want fixed to get to your beautiful neighborhood. Fix my road. You want my support? You give the county to the Lennar and do what they should do. The rest of the county.
The statement was get the county to fix the road. I can assure you.
But you have influence with the county.
Yeah, I don't know about that. Oh, just a second. Let me address her question real quick. With regard to the road improvements on Shanley Gap, keep in mind we're doing a lot of system improvements with the lights and all that.
But they're not going to let sewer down to us. We've always wanted sewer. You're going to get sewer.
Well, we're also just keep in mind we're paying $3 or $4 million to get that sewer line.
I know, but you want all of our support. Sure. You need to do some things that we need.
Well,
To address your
concern about the sewer, that's a big point. We are required to provide sewer easements to anybody that's upstream of this. One thing to keep in mind, just so everybody's not confused, the city is coming, serves this property with water and sewer. The county has the road, so you got two governments. The infrastructure improvements that are being put in for water and sewer are going to do nothing but help this entire area. I know some people have told me they're having septic problems. We're running a 12-inch water line all the way from Kelly Mill Road to Johnson Road, all the way down Shanley Gap Road to Bethelview Road. It's $2 million just for a water line.
You're putting in Johnson Road?
Yes, we are. We're putting in.
Where does that water come from?
The question is, where does the water come from? Jim, correct me if I'm wrong, but the water line on Kelly Mill, it was a 12-inch water line on Kelly Mill. That 12-inch line will be extended up Johnson Road. It will circle around down Shanley Gap all the way to Bethelview Road.
Do they have a water tank?
A water tank.
Yeah, where's the water coming from?
The water is coming from the 12-inch line on Kelly Mill Road.
City water.
It's city water. I mean, it comes from Lake Lanier, I guess.
You're missing the point. Sometimes when it happens to the other, you turn on the water and stop. But if everybody's using their water at the same time as there, it's too much of demand. And if you don't put more tanks in, somewhere you had this in home, it's going to be worse.
That's a good point. The statement was water pressure dropping. As you put more houses on the water line, pressure goes down. Whenever these projects come in now, new ones like this, we're required to maintain certain fire flows. We have to improve the city of Cummings water system to whatever we have to do to make sure. I would venture to guess, and Jim, step in if I'm wrong, that this is going to probably increase water pressure because we have to install this in order to fight fires in this entire area. So typically, especially when I've done stuff on the side of the mountains where people have water pressure issues, when those developments come in with those upsized water lines, that generally helps a significant amount. Just back to your point quickly on the sewer, we are, even though there's a gravity sewer line running right down the middle of this problem, the city of Cumming is making us do about $3 to $4 million worth of sewer improvement upgrades to its pump station and also to the sewer lines in this area to service all the upstream properties that the city serves between 20 and where this property is. So we're certainly open to looking at how we can help Bethwick, I know that's a problem, Shanley Estates. The goal in the county, because it's mandated by EPD, is to get people off of septic tanks and on sewer. That's what the county's goal is, that's what the state's goal is, and we're going to try to turn it into
Let's wait until it's your all have septic tanks. Shanley Estates has all septic tanks. How is Shanley Estates going to benefit from that sewer system?
The question is, how is Shanley Estates going to benefit from the sewer system? What we're required to do, and typically, Jim, you can jump in here in a minute, we're required to reserve easements along all the streams. What that means is the streams are the low point, right? That's where the sewer lines go. We have to, on our final plat, reserve easements to everybody who's upstream. Now, we're going to have sewer lines, obviously, serving all of these houses. And so what it does is it brings sewer closer to you. In Forsyth County, if your house is within 1 mile of a sewer line, you're supposed to tie onto it. That costs how much for a mile of sewer?
But the utilities county says that you have to pay $5,000 to put on.
In addition to paying however many hundreds of thousands it is to run the lines. So what we do as these developments come in, is it brings the sewer closer to people.
But you still have to play a cook into it.
That's the county and city's policy. They would call a tap on fee to tie in. But again, what it does is it saves you, the homeowner, the infrastructure cost of maybe running 2 miles of sewer line at a cost of $1,500,000 to get to it. Because that's really the big problem, is the sewer isn't close enough for it to be financially feasible to tie onto it, and that's what we're trying to solve.
$5,000 is a pretty high price, and since we're going to be directly impacted by this development, we should have a right to the sewer automatically, because we are going to be directly impacted. Right, our boundaries are going to be directly impacted by the development.
Yes, sir. First of all, you're quite the enigma, Josh, because on one hand, you seem to be bothered by government regulations, particularly land use plans, which have been adopted by the county and supported by its citizens. On the other hand, you know, you kind of go against your conservative nature there and tend to be a raging environmentalist. So I applaud you on your diversity of your views. What I would suggest to you, if you go back to the slide that was up there for a second, the one down the tunnels, I think that there is a consistent theme in that I don't care what you're saying, the fact is that you guys aren't motivated by the environment. You're not motivated by making our community a better community, because I don't think any of you guys are going to be moving into those homes. And you're not really motivated at the end of the day by becoming a great place to live. What you're motivated by is making money. You're putting a slide up there of two old people, pardon my language, two elderly people, pardon, I mean that. You're selling townhomes, and they're low-end, entry-price homes in a community that would point out, by the way, it's being built right across the street pretty much from another community where they've already leveled a pasture over there, and they're adding even more homes over there, and you're not listening to the people. Now, I have a close ex-relative of mine who was the chairman of the County Commission for Cherokee County, who was involved in a lot of votes on this kind of stuff. And I have a pretty dang good idea about how this kind of process works. I've worked in politics quite a lot. Describe to me your existing conversations and relationships with our county commissioners, and have you had any conversations with them already on the approval of this project?
Let me take your points one at a time, starting with the environmental issue. It is possible to like to maintain streams and buffers, and at the same time, not necessarily like all the things that the government tries to do to you. So I'm not trying to be left wing or right wing. I just think that what we're trying to do here is, and you say we're motivated by making money. Well, the issue, I understand, you know, everybody who owns a mutual fund in this room probably owns part of this company. So you have to make money to stay in business. But what I'm trying to emphasize is that it is better for Lennar's business not to run lots through the streams, to protect the streams. There is a lot of liability associated with runoff problems, with contamination of streams. I can tell you of instances where multi-million-dollar judgments have been handed down because a retention pond blew out. So it's not, again, that we don't want to put lots through the streams. It's, again, part of it is trying to maintain some of the environmental.
My point was to say you guys aren't the greenest.
I'm addressing your concerns. Please. As we move to your next question, you asked me about talking with the commissioners. Zoning, just so everybody knows, zoning is a legislative function of the government. The county commission sits in a seat, kind of like a mini Congress, and they pass the laws. The zoning map of the county is a law. It's part of the Unified Development Code. So we talk to the commissioners, just as everyone in this room has the right and the option to do. I will give you all their contact information personally if you want to do that. And we explain the project. They come to a lot of our community meetings. I see some of them here tonight. The commission, again, sits in a legislative function, and we're asking them to change the county's zoning map to allow this. Now, one point I do want to mention, is that as part of the county zoning law, the Board of Commissioners has a lot of discretion in what it does and does not do. But that discretion is limited by the state and federal constitution. And what that says is you cannot take private property without paying for it. Part of that taking, we're treating people differently. Part of that taking and part of that equal protection is giving people a land use. If you're going to require them to run sewer, if you're going to require them to pay impact fees, build roads, install system improvements, the county must rezone people's property to a constitutional zoning. Agricultural is not a constitutional zoning in Forsyth County anymore. There will be a zoning of this property. Whether it's this or something else, it will not stay like it is. That much I can assure you. We're trying to work with you to get the best plan we can, to get the best for the community. We're willing to sit down with you as many days, hours, weeks, months as it takes to work on this and try. I know you roll your eyes, but I've been doing this a long time, and I live here too, believe it or not. I live at the north end of Post Road on Evans Road, and I work here. My kids go to school here. I don't want to see the community develop in a bad way either. So again, we're trying to work with you. We're happy to do that, and I mean, I appreciate your opinions. I do. Everybody's entitled to that, and I understand.
Everybody in this room, is this going to be a Walmart?
Essentially start a home for young families.
That is true legally. I think we can sort of look at that.
It's something, it's Lennar.
Well, as Lennar has developed the property, I mean, again, it's a concept. So we're trying to figure out the best next, and we're starting to look at that. I mean, if that makes sense.
You mentioned liability, and I did. Because, you know, right now, Forsyth County is being held liable for the break of the dam on Lake Alps. Now, Forsyth County did not build the dam, did not build the lake, but they allowed the zoning. So I see all those creeks there, and I'm wondering how long before Forsyth County is held liable for the creeks that flood.
The question again, for anybody could hear, was the liability of the county for the creeks flooding. Mm-hmm. I think I know the case you're talking about with the dam blew out. I don't know details of it.
This project is going to finance the lawsuits that are going to arise out of that.
The county typically with the detention pond, which is really where you have the problem, the detention pond fails and it causes runoff, that kind of thing. That's where you see a lot of lawsuits filed.
That wasn't our town. That wasn't our lake.
Well, I understand.
The only liability we really have is the fact that we allowed the zoning.
Well, I'm not.
And now we're talking about allowing the zoning of 696 homes right up against creeks. We mentioned the water runoff. I know that there will be flooding. You know there will be flooding. And it won't be long before Forsyth County finds itself sued again.
By
the same family that's brought the zoning. Is suing, proposing to sue the county for flooding.
I want to address my issue about the runoff. Question again was a concern about runoff. Keep in mind that when the project is developed, the development will have curb and gutter, storm drains, piping systems to go to the detention ponds. You're not going to see sheet flow coming off the property like you do now. Where we're keeping the streams and the buffers, that helps slow down and filter some of that water. Most of it is piped into retention ponds where it is held and released more slowly. Yes. Physics works. When you put more stuff on the ground that water doesn't sink into, it increases runoff. But the way the law is written, you can't increase the runoff off of your property to any more than it was before you did anything to it. So what the flow is now, the rate of that cannot increase. Does it? Yes, it probably has to.
Yes, it does.
So, yes, I recommend it.
I can guarantee you that.
But really what that concern is a concern about following the law. Well, when you're dealing with somebody like Lennar, I can assure you they're usually a lot more concerned about that than maybe somebody who has no stake in it who might flip it or something like that. Todd can speak to this more clearly than I can, but I can't imagine the hurdles that you guys and the controls to put in place to limit that kind of thing.
Not only do we have to abide by the county laws, but we also have to abide by state and government laws. Being a publicly held company, we not only develop obviously here, but we do it all across the nation. So it is something that we take very seriously. If we were not diligent in our engineering, diligent in our developing, we wouldn't be able to continue doing what we're doing. We wouldn't be able to do this for 50 years. The same concerns that you have, we have. It doesn't behoove us to allow runoff into streams and allow it to bypass. All it does is aggravate our homeowners and aggravate the downstream homes. This is something we want this community to be here now, 10 years, 20, 30 years in the future. We don't develop at minimum standards. We are doing everything we can to maximize the efficiency, maximize the engineering, so that we don't have these issues. And we work with all the county. Very important that we work with all of the county departments to make sure that we're doing it by the book.
I think you have not asked a question yet. Sure. The question concerned was the houses in another development next to Polo Field that are age targeted, age restricted, cost more money. When we talk about townhomes being and the single family lots being in the low, I mean in the high twos, that is base. Typically, Todd can speak to this better than I can. The people who live in those products have more money than everybody else that's in the subdivision. And Todd, I'll let you speak quickly to them. The upgrades.
What we like to do in a community of this size is offer a wide range of product so it appeals to a wide range of buyers. We think it's important not only to have homes that apply to young families, but more senior families that have children that are about to move on in the 90-foot section with the bigger home sites and the larger bedrooms and baths. We also think it's important to allow if those grandparents want to live in that area. So what we've seen successful to limit traffic counts, limit school impact, is to combine all of those elements, design features, price points, lifestyles, combine it all into one area, and you minimize the impact overall. If this was, as I think Josh talked about earlier, the seller had the opportunity to take this in several sections and sell that off. Then you would have 600 home sites that basically look the same. Everybody wants to get into the elementary, middle, and high school. There, if they would sold to different entities, they would have limited amount of impact or help that they could give the county into those infrastructures. By doing it all at one time, we can address all of these concerns within one community. Pull back the community away from, or the lots away from the streams. Pull them off the vistas. Congregate into clusters, home neighborhoods that appeal to certain buyer profiles. And that's what we've seen. We see this happen all across the country. It creates a wonderful environment for not only the young families, the starters, but then also the elderly families, the more senior. And then we see at the community centers and the town greens where those different entities are coming together. And then that lifestyle is blending in the community rather than segregating off and say, you know, you're a starter family and you're not welcome in this community. You're a senior living type product and you have a need that you don't want to take care of your yards. You want to be able to go to a garden center. We don't want that in this part of our area. By putting that within one community, we give an opportunity to really blend that together, blend those lifestyles together. Then you see young families integrating with elderly families, learning from them. We see mentoring programs going on. We see tutorial programs going on in the different community centers that we have on site. It's a wonderful environment when you drive through a community like this and you see that mix, that blend. And this is a unique opportunity to do that.
You said uniquely, sir.
Josh, first of all, I want to recognize our newly elected District 3 Commissioner Todd Bett in the back. He seems to be on the commission.
Protected. You know, while it is also an amenity for the community, it is an amenity for the greater area, as we will have the greenway walking through there. So that will be deeded over to the HOA. We are building homes right now in the preserve community, in the preserve at Fieldstone. Same thing over there. Master HOA, separate HOAs for the pods. And I can tell you they're out there inspecting that area all the time and making sure that, one, it's clean, two, we're doing what we're supposed to be doing. They have a board for each of the HOAs that monitor that. So that exact same thing will be set up here to make sure that we stay out of and maintain.
Ma'am, I know your arm must be getting tired back there.
I'll get you next.
I had surgery on this one, I switched arms.
First of all, last year 95% of the zonings were on 1/4 of an acre lot sizes or smaller. So I don't think that the smaller lot size market is in any need. A lot of them were age-restricted communities that were already zoned and are going to be built out. That market is being satisfied. If you allow small lot sizes on this piece of property right here, you will set a precedence, and 30 seconds later, here will come Josh saying, well, they got it next door, and now this zoning here needs it, and this one here needs it, and here, this one here needs it, because that's what they do all day long. And you think that smashing in a bunch of homes like moon pies on a little piece of property is not going to cause damage to your property? Guess again, because Pulte got sued just under 2 years ago. They didn't go back in and fix things and remediate from the goodness of their heart. The homeowners had to fork up their own money and hire an attorney, and they won. And Riverbrook Properties, I stood in some woman's backyard and looked at her horse field, which is now sludge. And her whole backyard is full of trash from all the runoff from the Riverbrook neighborhood that was built behind her. So I'm just telling you, don't fall for it.
Well, let me address both of your questions. The first one being, quarter-acre lots, you're saying development quarter-acre lots. One thing to keep in mind, I think, yes, a lot of that is senior housing. But keep in mind, that just when, just because the zoning district says that a minimum lot size is X, say res 4 would be 8,000, res 3 would be 10, res 2 would be 18,500. Just because the minimum is imposed, most of the lots in the subdivision are larger than that. And when I say larger, I don't mean 10 feet larger. When you get to the cul-de-sac, some of these lots are approaching half an acre or more. And that's why you see in a lot of zonings these days, average lot sizes. So a minimum might be 10, but the average may be 14, because you've got 30,000, 20,000, 25,000 square foot lots. So they're not all, I understand the issue about minimums, but the code, you know how laws are written. The law is written to put a floor. They don't put a ceiling generally on it. So, you know, in fairness, I think that you have to take into consideration what the actual lots end up being. And again, in this subdivision, minimum lot sizes are what we're trying to show. We are working on trying to figure out, it's just a big project, what all of the lot sizes are as this plan is laid out. And so hopefully we'll be able to come back with some type of average, some type of this is going to go from here to here, and work on that. I understand that. Your second point about me coming back in, I think I've had the one I'm going to have right here, so I'll just let somebody else come in on that. But, yes, sir.
You said you were going to, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. You're right. Whoever is jumping up with their arm the minute I look.
She's been waiting for long.
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Patiently.
Yes.
Very patiently.
Different kind of question. When 600 to 1,500 cars start cutting through my subdivision on Pine Lake on Greenwood Acres Drive, are we going to be allowed to close it off and put a row of legal cypresses down there if they start?
Your question is cut through traffic and through Greenwood Acres. Greenwood Acres is over.
We're all shipping Shambly Gap to 20.
I've heard that raised from the gentleman.
Well, it's a big concern when you live where I live.
Well, I've heard that people use it, I guess, to cut over to high school.
Yeah.
Well, we can't close the county road. We don't.
I can.
You do what you need to do. I understand the issue. I've heard people say it's a
problem. It could be a problem.
So you're going to build 996 homes, and double that many cars are going to come up and down my quiet little street, and you're making it go back down to what we've got now, which is a little more than a paved path. Where drunk people are hitting the mailboxes because there's not enough road there, and it's too curvy.
Sure.
And you say you can't do anything.
Well, we are. The question again is improvements to Shambly Gap. We are, and I have to go back to read the development agreement impact conditions. We are not taking Shambly Gap back to exactly what it is. We were trying to take it back down to tie it back in so you get to go from the parkway to narrow two lane road. I think we are having to make improvements to certain sections of it.
We're going all the way to the school.
I understand.
I mean, I'm going to ask for what I feel like with. You want so much,
those of us who already live over there or used to a certain lifestyle, you're dumping 690 families in there.
With 2 cars per family.
2 cars per family.
What I hear everybody talking about is the number of houses. And, you know, is there a way to reduce the number of houses that are going to be put on this land? That's what we want our community to be. It's too late to be a Milton, right? We've got so much development going on in Forsyth County. We're on the path of being Alpharetta and or Gwinnett. And I don't think we want that. And I think that's where everybody's coming from is, you know, I drive through Alpharetta, and there's a reason I didn't live there.
Amen.
There's a reason I didn't live there. How do you run the numbers to get you what you want? And, you know, it is about money. It's not about altruism. You know, that's what development is. It's not all about altruism. And so, you know, how can you put less houses on that land, still make money, and preserve our community? Because I drive through Fieldstone Preserve, and I'm not impressed. I'm not impressed. The houses are pretty, but I'm not impressed with how they're laid out. And if you talk about distinct homes and all that stuff, I mean, come on, drive through Fieldstone Preserve. That's not a bunch of distinct homes that Lennar has put in there. They're big homes, they're pretty homes, but they're not distinct. And so, you know, the idea of putting less houses that are very similar, I mean, that's development. There's only so many plans a developer is going to do. You're not going to do custom homes, right? You're doing a big development. I get that. But let's not pretend like it's something that's not. So I think the real thing is about what we want our community to be, why we moved here in the first place, learn from what happened in these other areas of Georgia. I mean, Forsyth County is a clean slate. It's one of the few clean slates out there that could be developed and learn from all these other areas and make it the best place to live in Atlanta. That's, I mean, I think that's what everybody wants it to be. And I don't think that's the answer.
About 5 mailboxes. Are you going to widen, maybe straighten that? Because some of your property is on that upper corner there that you might could straighten that up a little bit.
The question is whether we're going to re-align or straighten the Chamber Gap part. Yes.
That part?
Wherever, yeah. I can't remember exactly.
It's off
where it's where it runs through our property.
We no, I'm talking about it comes off of your property.
We don't control the property.
But
we can certainly look at something like that, but
I believe your property is on the left side of the road.
If our property's touching it, then it's certainly going to be
where it borders Brian's property.
Is it so it's south of us?
Can I comment on that? Yes. If people go back to, I think I saw Todd here, you can go back and check. To improve Chamberlain Gap Road was a project on Splash 5 passed in 2003. But it's a project that has never been done. So you know, there may be some discretionary funds for other improvements on Chamberlain Gap beyond this this project. Or something that someone ought to check on.
Yes, ma'am.
First
off, my question to all the three of us is, how many currently occupied residences are going to be affected by the fellow behind me wanting to sell his land?
I'm not sure. I'm sorry.
Is this all farmer's land that's already purchased?
It is.
Or do you intend on acquiring residences bordering this land?
The question is whether we're buying land in addition to this that has houses on it now. I don't think that Lennar is doing that.
Okay, because it said on that map, after I asked my chief, it said that five residential homes would be affected by this.
I'm sorry, it's on this property. I'm sorry, I thought you were talking about somebody else's property. Now, there are mobile homes or something on this.
No, there are not, because they're in our neighborhood, the two houses.
Mine, honestly, you know, we live on Mountain Valley. We've had 2 acres back there forever. You know, we have our own freedom. Yeah, we have our own freedom back there. And if this is going to be affected, then we need to talk. Because I put in a lot of money into this place.
Sure.
And I need to find out where that's going to cut off, okay? And where you guys are going to start. And if my property is affected by this.
Sure. If you would take one of my cards and give me a chance.
Okay.
Yes, sir. The houses that are being taken are from Shanley Estates, the two corner houses. And you can't put in, I like the Parkway monument, it's pretty, but you can't put it in without taking those two houses. When you get your traffic light, those two houses are gone. Anybody that lives in Shanley Estates is going to have a lot of trouble getting out.
Yes. Especially if you go south.
I'm going to let Todd speak to the acquisition of homes at the intersection. Todd, do you, because I think he knows more about that than I do.
Yeah, at the entrance, we will have to widen out, and we're working through whether those houses will stay as a part of the neighborhood or whether they'll be assumed into the greater community that we're talking about today. We're just not through the engineering on that section there.
We've got covenants for our neighborhood, though. They violate our covenants.
I'm sure you want to see them.
Well, won't 20 affect you guys anyway? The widening of 20 is going to take most of that, right?
Not us.
Widening of Bethany.
Oh, sorry.
Josh, we're too far back. I hesitate to speak out of this gentleman because I wouldn't put it. Really, what I'm seeing is it's too big. And I think we all feel this way. And what I see happening is it doesn't need the land use plan adopted by the counties. It just doesn't. The open area is being used to boost the density numbers as a way around it. And I don't care anything else being done to address the concern. The land use plan is there for a reason. We feel this way, and I think it's the same reason that we're speaking this way that we are about too big. When you say to improve our quality of life, I'm one of the people who's going to be turning left on that, or trying to. And I'm another one of these people who, when I came here a little over 4 years ago, I looked a lot of places. My job is in Alphabet. I've never had more than a 15-minute commute, but I have a 25 to 45-minute commute now, and I love it because of where I live. And so, really, this is, it's frankly just too big. I don't want to live in Alphabet. Please don't bring Alphabet to us.
Okay, the concern is that it's too big. I will point out, for what it's worth, and I'm not saying it's going to win anybody over, I understand I'm not living in fantasy land, but the density of this development is much less than pretty much everything else that's being zoned and built today. Much less.
You have to break that up into six individual units. You'd never be able to increase.
What if you take out the open area in the map? Take out open area in the map.
But in fairness, they say take out the open space and then calculate the density.
Take out the unusable land.
It goes back to what the county's ordinance tells us to do and how everybody in this room's neighborhood was calculated. I didn't write the law. I just know that it says use the whole piece of property. Everybody in here who lives in a subdivision, the whole property was used. Most of the subdivisions around it probably don't have any space required.
And none of them have 440 acres, to be fair.
Right. True. But my point in saying that is we don't get to pick how the density is calculated. It's calculated based on the county's code, and it's calculated the same way as everybody else's density.
I don't have a problem with the number, Josh.
Yeah, but you're using the master plan and removing the 25% requirement to group all that together, even though most of it's unbuildable.
If you have to
request the six individual permits, you'll never be able to reach that density.
To your point about the commercial acreage is used in the density calculation.
Kelly Mill Elementary School or Sony or every school around is going to be impacted. Drive down Kelly Mill on a school morning, right? Now you're going to the Shanley Gap out to Kelly Mill Road. Complete that, right? Bethlehem, not long yet. It'll get done eventually, right? More school bonds are going to have to be approved. It's not how we got to the number. It's strictly the number. It's the number of homes.
I think the other thing that's coming into play, you made a great point about the commission. And I think that's what everybody needs to take away from this is these guys are business, they're developers. Our bigger issue is our commissioners. Our zoning commission, people who are voted commission, local politics is the most important politics. You gotta have the right people in charge of that. You know, because my question is, who's on that commission approving this stuff?
Well, one of them is the seller.
So these guys are dealing, I mean, they're a business, right? They're going in and doing what they need to do. We can get on them all day, and anything they do there is out of the goodwill of their heart and trying to be a good part of our community. And I would, you know, applaud any considerations to reduce the number of houses, but I understand you're a business. Our bigger issue is the commission and our local politicians. And that's who we have to get the ear of. Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned schools, and I know you live and work in Forsyth County. I know your kids go to school in Forsyth County. I work for the school board. Maybe that's a good thing, maybe it's a bad thing to say, but I do. Kelly Mill is already over capacity. It's sitting at, it's supposed to be 1,125, but we currently have 1,217 kids. Projected for next year, 1,288, the following, 1,349. Brandywine will not be built until the 16-17 school year. Brandywine will not impact this school, this zoning. It's down off of McFarland. You say that we're passing the SPLOS and everybody wants to live and work here and everything, but when schools are built, they're built on current enrollment. By the time we get our money from bonds and SPLOST in the state, it's 10 years down the road. That you can't build for future enrollment. So we already have trailers. Otwell is already over capacity. Capacity is 1025. They're already at 1164. Next year, 1227. There is no future plan right now, or money, or land for a middle school. Central capacity is 1275. It's under. Nobody wants to go to Central. My kids went to Central.
Well, we do, because we're in the Central District.
And my kids went there too. Both graduated. Both graduated.
This project's in the Central District. So.
That's the only thing it's not going to impact is the high school. So are we going to tell everybody moving in, oh, if you have an elementary child, you can't move here. You have a middle school, you can't move here. No, of course you can't do that. There's not a high school being built. So I understand that you're saying that you want to bring the good things here, you want to bring the good life, but where are we going to put these kids?
No, it's a fair point. I know that the schools are always an issue. We have to do
And more. Mr. Amos bought in the newspaper. It's not going to affect the schools. I've thought about the schools because Central's under capacity. He didn't mention Kelly Mill or Otwell.
What I have heard from meeting school officials about this, we sat down with the incoming principal at Central and talked to some of the school board members about it, and that Kelly Mill is over capacity and will be over capacity regardless of this project, is what I've heard.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
what and we're trying to dump 696 houses.
I'm trying to be fair. I'm trying to tell you the facts that I know. And what we're trying to do is we have to, they don't have school impact fees in this county, but what we're trying to do is work on a partnership with the school system so that Lennar can try to help address some of these issues. We're certainly open to doing that. I don't know what form it's taking yet because it's still in its infancy stage, but we are working to do the most we can to help the school because, remember, we have to sell these houses. And
oh, you'll sell them because
if people think their kids don't have anywhere to go to school, they might not buy it.
So I understand the concern.
It's the best school district in the state. You're not going to have a problem selling the houses.
I don't know what control I've got over it, but I hope that the school board, at least the maps I've seen, they're planning for the future growth.
We're trying, but this isn't helping.
Let me get him, and then I'll come right back to you.
All these people that are going to these schools are going to be going down Greenwood Acres Drive. No one's gonna cut. I really think we're missing an opportunity to preserve the community that y'all love to develop. By not protecting the people who live along this road, you're going to put an extra 1,000 cars on it. It's a very narrow road. It's a very dangerous road, especially when you put a few extra 100 teenagers on it.
I'm going to plant some trees in the middle of it.
I'll help you dig the hole.
We will lobby with you. The question again was the Greenwood Acres Drive.
Yes.
We're happy to lobby with you, work with you to get the county to put in some kind of traffic calming measures. I mean, we can't.
Can you close Chamblee Gap Road? Close it at Johnson. Just close it.
We can't close the government's roads. I mean, we have work with them.
Can you develop out Johnson so more people are encouraged to get to Kelly Mill by taking that road as opposed to destroying all these other communities? Sorry, I'm trying for anything, you know. I mean, I don't think.
Okay, he has been flagging me for about 20 minutes. Let me grab him and then you.
Speaking of Lennar, are you guys the sole?
The Greenway's going to be 25.
Builder, the sole. You're not subbing anything out. You're doing everything yourself. There's no other entities involved in this development.
Right now, we have the property, the total property. The question was, is Lennar the only entity? Right now, yeah, absolutely. We would be the master developer for the community. If there is another builder that we feel comfortable with that wants to take a pod, we may consider that. I wouldn't say that we're opposed to that. But primarily, we're approaching this as if it is our community, all of it start and finish. You know, and when we think about that community, we do think about other parts of the city where we build. I know the road is tough, whereas I've seen the same thing. I do have to say that this is probably one of the best areas that I have seen in terms of the zoning process. A great public participation, a great planning commission, a great board of commissioners. There's a lot of open discussion that in other areas just frankly doesn't happen. What we've seen in those other areas are those areas get fragmented. So instead of having 400 acres that are well thought out, that are bringing different communities, lifestyles, people, pods together, working together, they'll section it off and do 50 lots here and 100 lots there. Then all of a sudden you're 10 years down the road. You haven't thought through a comprehensive use for that area. And so by doing this, you would have 600 homes all going to the schools. That's why we're trying to provide different lifestyles, age targeted, by pulling 200 plus homes off the market that go into the schools. So those are the things that we're trying to think through. You know, we don't create demand. We really don't. I would like to think that I'm smarter than that. I can create demand. I can't. All I can do is meet demand. And demand, because of what a wonderful county you have, people want to live here. It has one of the lowest months of supply of homes on the market in all of the city. Whether it's me or the next guy or the next builder, they're coming. You guys have created a wonderful county. The planning commission, the zoning commission, the school board have created a wonderful community. And people want to be a part of that. It's nothing to be ashamed of. But when thinking through this, rather than fragmenting it off, why can't we partner together and think of a larger community where we're bringing those different lifestyles together? That's what we've tried to bring today.
Yes, ma'am.
You made a statement that Forsyth County doesn't allow impact fees for schools. I want you to tell me what county in the state of Georgia has gotten around the law that we can do an impact fee for schools. So I'd like to know about that.
Yes, the question is why the county doesn't charge impact fees for schools. My understanding, and I have not looked at this because I'm not the county's attorney, but from talking with him, I think the reason impact fees aren't charged is because state law dictates what you can charge them for, and I don't think that schools are permitted under state law to be charged assessed impact fees.
Correct.
So I don't think it's anything to do with the county.
That's not the way you implied it in your statement. Well, I'm sorry, I misspoke.
What I'm trying to say is the impact fees, I don't think, are permitted for schools under the state.
Well, I just wanted to find out where we can figure out the law.
Clarify that.
acres, 3 to 5 acre lots. And the houses on Shamley Gap are 3 to 9 to 10 acre lots. The people on the Kelly Mill Trace, they were all 5 acre lots. And then you come in with this that has this many houses on this many acreage. It's just not in proportion with what that area is and started at. Greenwood was one of the first subdivisions we built here since Larry was born here, bless his heart, and we've seen it. You all have come and transplanted, and you know, we don't mind transplants, but I mean, you're putting a lot of transplants in an area that is so in several acre lots, not lots, in lots that has, you know, 10 acres,
right.
5 acres, 3 acres, and it just doesn't coincide with what that area is about. And also, I wanted to know if, now we're on septic tanks down there, and you've talked about what's uphill, but we're downhill from you. So, you know, we gotta watch streams and septics and all that downhill from you. Also, I wanted to know, does this have to be approved by the state first, since it's a large development?
The question is, does this have to be approved by the state as a large development? Yes, ma'am. To answer your question, then it has.
It has already been approved.
Just before I take any more questions, they close at 9, and we have to pack all this up, so I think if we can stop about 8:30. What I would recommend to everybody, what I like to do after these big meetings is have compartmentalized meetings with the individual neighborhoods. So if any of you are living in an adjacent neighborhood and you're the spokesperson or you know the spokesperson, please take one of my cards and call me, and we're happy to come sit down with you at your clubhouse or wherever and meet. But I just want to say that before we get to meeting. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I'm just checking, and I would like to know the thought process that was put into place as to why they decided to put townhomes, senior townhomes, next to Bethwood subdivision that is sitting on half acre lots. Now the other part of the question is, you're talking about a buffer zone. You said 25 foot buffer zone. I think a larger buffer zone would be more accommodating to everyone in the neighborhoods that live on half acre or larger lots. And the third part of the question is, who will control the buffer zone? Because the buffer zone behind our subdivision is controlled by the homeowner, and they've gone in and torn down the trees. Does it go back to, what is it, the Republic Trust, or the Homeowners Association? Who's gonna handle that? How are you gonna protect our properties and the lifestyle that we have?
To answer your question about who owns the buffers and all that, the HOA in our neighborhood owns that area between the senior townhomes and your property. They control it, and you can't, there have been situations, you can encumber it with what's called a conservation easement, and that easement is given to the county, but it's probably not necessary here where you have an HOA that controls it. It will not be owned by the individual lot owners. You're speaking to exactly what I was talking about earlier, which is trying to police 700 people instead of trying to police one entity that controls everything. So the buffer, to go to your next question, which was the 25-foot buffer and what we're going to do with that, we are certainly happy. Again, I know that Mr. Laughing House lives in your neighborhood. We're happy to come meet with you, walk it, look at it, run the elevation, see where everything is, landscape, whatever we can do to try to work on that. That's why I like to have these separate meetings once we, it's hard to negotiate anything, but so you can, Mr. Laughing House, call me. Was there somebody else?
To this is a little bit too much.
Well, that's why we had to anybody else? I'm happy to say it's late.
Nice to meet you.
that's the